and welcome to Two as One Couples, the show where we discuss matters marriage, going back to the Bible and asking ourselves, what was God's original intention for marriage? Now, we are going to discuss the issue of eunuch, the man becoming a eunuch, and how do you go back to the original position that God created you for? How do you stand in your posture as the man that God created in Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2, and then we see man falling in chapter 3, becoming something different from what God created? Now, we see that after the fall of man, God talks to the man and to the woman and to the serpent. But when he talks to the man, he tells him that with much sweat you will produce very little. And of course, to the woman, he tells her that with what you have done now, you will start desiring your husband. Meaning, in the beginning, it was not so. Her desire was for God. But in these two statements, God already reveals to us that you will become a strong woman, one who will be wanting to rule over her husband. And of course, for the man, you'll become a eunuch. That's it. You will become an unproductive. What you will have is so little compared to what I created you to be. Now, the question is, now when man discovers that he is a eunuch, how do you go back to the Father and become the man that God created you to be? My name is Susan Opio, and of course with me in studio.
My name is Charles Opio. And as we look at this picture, it's always a good picture of returning. And I think one of the most important pictures we need to understand is that something strange happened when man fell. We always will revolve that. I mean, revolve.
I think in every show we mentioned that.
2 years from now, we'll still be mentioning that. One of the other things that happened is that the relationship between man and God changed from father-son to fallen God.
To a fallen
man and a God.
And a God.
Before that, it was a father and his son who is God. You get? This is God. Who is God? Creator, powerful, omnipotent, everything.
Yes.
But in relationship with his son, who is he?
A father.
All right? When that is broken, the only part remaining is he is God.
So this same son, Adam, who used to look at him as father, now he's looking at him as God.
Absolutely.
You are creator of the world out there.
Yes.
I'm now even scared of you.
Yes.
I'm even hiding from your voice. I heard your voice and I was afraid.
Yes.
You can't be afraid of the voice of your father.
So, and since then, the picture of man has become a doing, not a being. This is our problem.
Okay.
Bible says when God created man, man became a living soul. Not, in other words, other versions say a human being.
Yes.
Not a human doing. This is our problem. When man fell, he didn't know that the human being connected to God could do on behalf of God.
Okay.
Now, the human being has lost his being.
Now he's doing.
He's doing to try and be.
Wow. So for me to go to my God, now the Father, who now I'm seen as God, I need works.
Yes.
I need activities.
So I've switched from relationship to servanthood.
Wow.
And whenever there is a servant, relationship deteriorates naturally.
Yeah.
Just think about it. But where there's relationship, servanthood increases. It's weird, but that's how it works.
Yes. That's powerful.
When you have a relationship, you enjoy working.
Oh, yes.
Nobody tells you. But when you work, you reduce relationship. A worker avoids the boss.
Oh, yes. And every time the boss walks in, there's fear.
Absolutely.
Every time there's a thought of the boss. So when we see from a fallen position, when we see view God as God and not as Father, we are full of fear, always hiding from him.
Why? Because you expect the boss to value your work, not you. It is the work he evaluates.
Every time boss comes, he's not interested with, how are you doing?
You are unimportant.
What are you doing?
Exactly.
Wow.
And with that picture of God, we've built religion. We've built everything from there. And we even monitor, threaten, and keep people under that threat.
Activities.
What even are as you leaders, doing?
Yes.
If you don't do this, God will get you. If you don't touch that, God is angry.
Is that why now when we walk into church, the first thing I want is, I've come, what can I do?
Thank
I
you.
Want to serve the Lord. I want to do something in the sanctuary, quote unquote.
And I know, in our community, we are very confusing when you join us, because we tell you, just sit.
Be fast.
Be. Learn who we are, learn who your father is. Mm. In every other community, you're told, do something for the Lord. Mm. You can't just be hanging around. What aren't you doing? What's the picture you get?
The first thing is be the son of God, coming back to realizing that he is your father.
Absolutely.
That's the first call.
So, I want to ask a few questions of what is your picture of God.
Wow.
Because your perception of God will determine your level of life.
Hmm.
It's as simple as that.
Can I tweet that?
Yes. Yeah, it's true.
Yeah.
Because, first of all, these perceptions are correct. But when they're not laced with Father, they're dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
All of them.
Okay.
So the perception that he's a creator, it is correct.
He is the creator.
Absolutely. It's like saying, I'm sitting outside a particular gate of a factory.
Mm-hmm.
I know what they manufacture in there. I know how wealthy they are, but I'm not related to them.
Hmm.
How do I get in?
Hmm.
Only if I can get a job.
Wow.
Problem.
Because there's no relationship.
Nothing.
So the only other connection to this huge, beautiful place that I would love to get in is through a job.
And I am guaranteed in that job, there are 99.9% chances I will never meet the owner.
Yo. So here we are, bring it to us and God.
Yes.
I can see his creation.
Yeah, created the
I can talk about it.
Yes.
And I think there's one thing we all talk about, the galaxies. God created
everything.
The galaxies. God created the sun, the moon, and all these things. But if I'm standing fine looking at him and saying, wow, for me to access his creation, I only go as a servant.
Yes.
With my works.
And the only way you will ever meet him is when you're dead.
Yes, that's another way.
Yeah.
Actually, the only way. To meet
the
father.
Owner of this factory.
Yeah.
When you die.
Mm.
That's when he'll be happy to have you.
Yeah.
And when you die, he will check how well you served in his factory.
Mm.
At which level you are.
Mm.
It will determine your mansion. I'm just using our doctrines.
Yes. Wapped up, yeah?
The next thing we know is that he's a provider. Interesting. Jehovah Jireh, we quote it all the time.
Mm.
But it's like saying, I know a rich and wealthy man who has everything, but he might give me if I can find favor with him. So until I find favor with him, there is no way of getting his provision.
So that is when we all stand up and say, you know what, even in my prayers, I don't see him as father. I give him titles. You are Jehovah, my provider, not my father.
So he's like a rich man who walks out. We're still using the guy outside the factory.
Yes.
The owner walks out and you beg.
You beg, please.
Please.
Give have me favor on me.
Absolutely.
Mm.
We even talk about, hey, by the way, favor can come on you. No, it will not come on you. Favor is something you carry.
Mm. As long as you're a son of God, favor is part of your
DNA. It operates in your environment.
Mm.
It's not something you get.
Yeah.
Finding favor means others are in disfavor.
Mm, and meaning that God is a respecter of persons.
He's choosy.
Mm.
And he chooses the best behaved.
So still, we are
So we create laws.
Yeah.
We create principles.
Yeah.
If you're going to get provision, this way we get our doctrine, he who does not work,
should not eat. Yeah.
Now we need to understand the context of that scripture today.
Mm-hmm.
Because too many people have used it as an abuse of both men and God. Because Bible says, I have never seen the righteous forsaken.
Mm-hmm.
Or his children?
Begging for bread. Yeah.
If God is your provider, who told you should work for food? Now we need to understand the context of Paul. Paul's context of that scripture was very specific.
Yeah.
There was a group of people that were going around deceiving people. These people that were deceiving people were deceiving people that they were called of God.
Mm-hmm.
They were giving doctrines that were inaccurate. And when Paul says, he who does not work should not eat, he was talking about the work of the ministry.
Mm-hmm.
These guys don't take the time to interact with God.
Mm.
They don't take the time to get concepts and realities that can change your life.
Yes.
But they're going around fooling widows, getting free food in the name of God.
Mm.
So this work here is not physical labor that he's talking about.
So he's talking about a specific group of people.
Yes, and the word he who does not provide for his household, the word provision there has got to do with providing insight and patterns from God.
Can we dwell on that a little bit? Because that's another one that has confused that.
Yes.
He who
does not provide for his family
is worse than
an
infidel, an unbeliever.
There are many, many. Now, let me ask a question.
Okay.
Think of Paul comparing somebody who cannot bring food home to an unbeliever.
Okay.
Meaning an unbeliever is better.
Mm-hmm.
Because the unbeliever does what?
Brings food.
Really? He brings
food
home.
So what food? There's a food here we are missing out.
Okay, let's go secular first.
Okay.
Assuming this is what Paul is saying.
Mm-hmm.
He's saying who does not provide for his family is worse than an unbeliever.
Yeah.
Why is he not worse than a lazy man?
Mm-hmm.
Because that should be the comparison.
Yeah.
The comparison should be, he who does not bring food home is worse than a lazy man.
But he's saying an unbeliever.
Why is he connecting these two things?
Hmm.
He's saying he who does not bring God's insight to his family is worse than an unbeliever.
Hmm.
That is the measurement.
Because an unbeliever doesn't even know.
The unbeliever brings money. He brings everything.
Yeah, but
he doesn't bring God.
Hmm.
That's what Paul is dealing with.
So when you talk of provision there, we are talking about spiritual provision.
Everything. Listen, in the Bible context, it is not that that person now doesn't provide food and shelter.
Mm.
But that is the least
in
the kingdom.
Because I was going to say that, because that will contradict what Jesus said.
Yes.
Don't seek these things.
It's the least.
Your Father knows.
Absolutely.
This will be added.
Thank you.
Yeah? So provision of food is the least. When
the
you talk
least.
Of the list of provision.
It's like when Jesus talks of the parable of the talents, when he says you should have at least put it in the
bank. So he's telling you that's
in the kingdom,
least level.
That is the least investment level. Putting
so
money
when
in
you
bank.
Talk of provision of spiritual food to your family is greater than provision of natural food.
Why? Because spiritual food is not Bible study.
Yes.
Spiritual food is connecting with heaven, getting patterns, plans, strategies of God for the family, prophesying the destiny of your children, speaking into those environments, getting strategies from God on how to develop your business or whatever, so that everything works. So Paul is saying you are disconnected from source. You are worse than an unbeliever.
Wow. And again, if you do this provision where we say spiritual provision.
Yes.
Like Jesus put it in Matthew 6, when you have the supernatural provision, the natural will follow.
Absolutely.
This is not what you should be chasing.
Yes.
So if we come to a place of saying, listen, are you providing for your family?
Yes.
What are we talking
it's
about?
It's a deep question.
Are you giving your family spiritual direction? Are you guiding them into the ways of God? Are you leading them back to the Father?
Remember Mary and Martha and Jesus?
Mm-hmm.
Tell my sister to come and help me.
In this.
She has chosen
the better
thing. Mm. Not that the other one is bad.
Mm, but this is better.
This is the key.
Yeah.
The food you're preparing is so that people can sit and hear this word.
Mm.
This word will cause food to come.
Yeah.
What is the center?
Mm.
The word.
The word.
Now, if you have a picture of God as creator and picture of God as provider, but you don't have him as father, you'll have this problem.
Yeah.
You'll be one of those people who believe God is everywhere but nowhere.
Mm.
In other words, he has all the power. I mean, I've asked this question to my congregation before, and I'll ask it to many of you. Who believes God can do anything? Who believes God can provide for you? Who believes God can heal you?
Mm.
Who? See, the can is never a problem.
Mm.
The will is the problem.
Mm.
If I ask you who believes he will, then there is a pause.
Mm. But I believe he can heal. He can provide. He can do all this.
This is
he will
problem.
Provide for me, then I'm...
Only a son can believe he will.
Wow. A servant wonders.
He knows he
can. Without works?
No, in fact, we know. They'll even tell you, oh, rich people are the most stingy. In other words, he can, but he won't.
Hmm. So that's creating God in our own image, after our own
absolutely.
Likeness.
Absolutely.
Looking at God with the eyes of men.
Thank you.
If a rich man cannot provide for me, this God we call so rich.
Yes.
Does not provide for me until I do something. And I think also that mentality of we have to do something has been passed on so much in our churches, in our religious circles, that we actually walk around with a mentality of until I do something, he will not respond.
Thank
until
you.
I give him something, he will not give back.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
Another name we have for God, good name, but if he's not your father, it's a problem.
Yeah.
Savior. Now what's the problem with that?
Yeah.
Is he not a savior?
He is.
But you see, the problem is that if you think of him as God, your focus will be, if you repent, he will forgive.
Mm.
Sounds good. No. He forgave before you repented.
Mm. When we are yet sinners.
Different picture.
He already loved you. He died for you even before you knew him.
So the picture we get with this mentality of God the Savior, he's a God, remember what we are saying, he's out there, he can save. But there are conditions. You meet the conditions, He will save you.
Go back to that again. If you repent, God will forgive you. No.
No. Mm. He forgave you.
Already.
And then set a standard, says, I've already forgiven you.
Receive it.
Repentance is accepting my forgiveness.
Wow.
Repentance does not activate my forgiveness.
Mm.
It simply accepts my forgiveness.
Mm.
That's the principle.
Mm.
The father and the prodigal son. Coming home, you find him always there. All right, and the problem with having this syndrome of God who is away, then when you see him as a savior, you don't see him in the context of he is the one who initiates the saving.
Mm-hmm.
You see yourself as the one who activates the process.
Yes.
So that means you have to keep doing a checklist of your sins, because remember, you're coming, I'm giving you a compound thought.
Yeah.
He's a creator, he has power,
mm-hmm.
he's a provider.
He can.
When he wants.
Mm-hmm.
Now, for him to provide and save me, I must meet the criteria.
Mm.
So to meet the criteria, I must do something. Yet, we know that it is what he did, not what we did.
It is not our works.
It was never us.
It is what is already accomplished.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So the Savior principle here is the one who came to rescue you,
mm.
not the one you call out to rescue you.
Mm.
See the joke I always give,
yeah.
where people say, you know, since in the last 20 years, when I found Jesus, no, you didn't find Jesus.
He found
you. He wasn't lost. You are the one who was lost.
Yeah.
Jesus was fine.
Yeah.
You are the one who was lost.
Yeah.
You didn't find Jesus.
Yeah.
Jesus found you.
But that is now our warped up concept.
Absolutely.
That it is me who comes to looking for him.
Yes.
Yet we don't understand he wants you to access his salvation more than you want to be saved.
Absolutely.
It is his, that's why he even died before you knew him.
Mm-hmm.
He loved you before you knew him.
Now,
so, Savior.
Now, the other problem is this new, this other name we like, our friend.
Yeah.
God was the friend of Abraham.
Yes.
The problem is, think of a servant, okay,
mm-hmm.
who becomes a friend of the boss. What is the most likely thing he's going to do?
Mm-hmm.
He's going to become over familiar. It's natural.
Yeah.
I mean, just the awesomeness that you're close to the boss now.
Yeah, no, he's not just close. He's my friend.
Everybody else.
He's my friend.
Yeah. So
he calls me friend.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So what begins to happen?
Yeah.
There's a childishness that now is brought in,
mm.
not childlikeness.
Mm, childish.
It's a childishness.
So you're supposed to be like.
Yeah, yeah. Now God is daddy.
Ah.
We have all sorts of cliches to show how friendly we are with God. We remember. Like I said, when a servant walks with the boss, how does he act?
I find it strange when you come and find someone giving a testimony and saying, you know, I was sitting and I told the guy up there.
Yes.
You're like, really? I mean, like, really? You know? And yet you see people find it normal because of what you're saying.
Yep.
You've come to places where you find people telling you, you know what? I could have done 1, 2, 3 bad things. But you know what? By grace, because now he's my friend.
Yes.
Grace is there. I can do what I want and then call on grace. You know, that is the familiarity
Absolutely.
You're talking about.
So all these things are good only in the context of if he is God or if he is Father.
He is Father.
Your Father can be your friend. You know that.
But the relationship,
but the reverence doesn't change.
I think that reverence is where we lose it.
That kind of friendship is more powerful because that friendship has to do with intimacy and secrets.
Is this bringing?
It doesn't have to do with show off.
Is this bringing Babylon to church?
Absolutely.
Is this bringing the worldliness?
Yes.
Where now, because I want the youth to get it, I come and introduce them to man Jesus.
JC.
What are these? What is this? Listen, if I see him as man JC, it means there's a way I will not believe that.
He can change
me. He can change my life. When I start seeing him as this buddy, and then I'm bringing him this devil. You notice we don't bring devil to our level.
No, no.
We don't call him this devil.
No, devil is deadly.
Devil is serious. But when you come to man JC, then you look at him and say, this guy cannot handle the devil.
Yes.
And that is why now our prayers, when we talk of Jesus and we say, you know, Father, I love you, there everybody is quiet. But the minute you say, and now devil,
everybody
now gets up because this one is serious.
Yes.
We don't know how to joke with
Absolutely.
Him. I think that friendliness.
So you see those two extremes.
Yeah.
And also, what a friend of a boss does, a friend of a boss is never genuine.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't want to lose the friendship.
Yeah.
So in the context of remaining a friend, he's dangerous to the other workers.
Yeah.
First of all, he shows off.
Mm-hmm.
He's the one closest to him.
Yeah.
He's the one who's always with the boss.
Mm.
And he knows things you don't know.
Mm.
He'll never introduce you to the boss because that will change.
And if I tell you something that you don't know, you'll act like you know because I don't want to show I don't know because I'm supposed to be closer to the friend.
And the friend of the boss will even create fake stories.
So there are revelations that you'll decide, I already know that, don't
tell.
But you don't walk in any of them.
And if you're a man of God who is a friend, in that sense, not a son who is a friend, what will happen? You'll have all these exclusives from God that can't even be found in Scripture.
Yeah.
No, God, when I was praying, God told me.
God showed me,
but it cannot be proven in his character and nature.
Yeah.
But a father and a son, there are things they discuss. He will not tell you what he talked to his father about. He'll tell you what is relevant. He will not even, does a father need to tell you, by the way, I was with my father this morning. Who else? That's who you're supposed to be with.
Your relationship demands
that you have. We already understand that.
Yes,
that this is the norm. We know that in public we are what we are, but when you guys are at home, you are closer. That's a principle.
So when God shows you his patterns and everything as a son, you don't see it like a privilege in that sense, but you know, I am here to represent him. I'm supposed to be knowing his blueprint, his patterns, his templates.
And the friendship with your father has to be to do with higher levels of access.
Yeah.
Not with just familiarity. The friend with your father has to do with knowing the voice and the character so well that you're able to operate correctly. Now, if you begin to understand that picture, the eunuch needs to remove the picture of God with all these things and switch it to the father with the same things. Because now the father, being the creator, is a co-creator. He wants to show you the mysteries of his creation.
Entirely
different relationship. As the provider, he wants your confidence, not only in his provision, but to represent him as a provider yourself. Everything begins to change. Things shift
so
now.
So wait a minute there. As a provider, he wants to show you, I can provide for you, but I want you to make the provider to those around you.
Absolutely.
So it's not a lot about me, but me having more than enough to actually provide.
And then you begin to understand, being my father, he has many lost sons. I have an assignment to bring them home.
Yes.
A servant doesn't want more servants. The salary will be reduced. The economy is out of order. That perspective completely shifts you from eunuch to son.
Wow. Is there anything else you can say? I mean, you've had this man. You need to go back to your father and ask yourself, is he my father?
Or is he just God?
Or is he just God? Stay tuned as we continue in Two as One Couples. God bless.